नमस्ते सर्वभ्य। टुडे वी विल बी हैविंग आवर सेवेंथ सेशन ऑफ शास्त्र सेतु सीरीज टाइटल्ड एज आयुर्वेद एंड इट्स कंसेप्ट ऑफ प्रकृति एन इंजीनियर्स गाइड। सो आवर स्पीकर फॉर टुडे विल बी श्री बाला किशोर, हु इज अ वाइस प्रेसिडेंट एट स्कैर्स टेक्नोलॉजीज, एन आईटी इंडस्ट्री वेटरन विद मोर देन 25 ईयर्स ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस, एंड ही इज करंटली परस्यूइंग हिज पीएचडी एट एमआईटी स्कूल ऑफ वैदिक साइंसेज। His research area is an Ayurvedic framework for personalizing wellness for one's lifestyle. So this talk will give an overview of Vedic science of Ayurvedic and will specifically address some questions like the meaning of Ayurveda and its fundamental theory and basic concepts. So now I would like to hand over to Sri Balakishore to continue the session.
Thank you, Nikunji. Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us. So if you're okay, let's start with this session with a couple of minutes of meditation. Is that okay? So sit straight, sit back, relax. You can close your eyes. Have both feet firmly on the ground. Don't fold your arms, don't fold your legs. Take a deep breath. Breathe slowly and deeply. As you breathe in, observe the muscles of your stomach expand. As you breathe out, observe the muscles of your stomach contract. Breathe slowly and deeply. Even if your mind goes elsewhere, acknowledge the thought, ignore it, and gently bring your attention back to your breathing. Breathe slowly and deeply. Relax yourself and let go of any tension in part of your body. Gently open your eyes. Thank you. This is one of the easiest ways to relax the self within 75 to 90 seconds. That's the time we spend. Because when you consciously breathe slowly, as many of you must have experienced, we relax because our parasympathetic nervous system gets activated. When you are stressed, your sympathetic nervous system gets activated. And when your parasympathetic nervous system gets activated, you feel relaxed. And thinking, breathing, and our life or aging are very closely related. That is why breathing is also called as prana. When you breathe slowly, you think slowly. When you think slowly, you age slowly. When you breathe fast, you think fast, and vice versa, and you age fast. One of the age-old Ayurvedic principles. That is why the focus is always on controlling our mind and controlling our senses. Good. So let's begin. So let me share my screen. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes.
Wonderful. So I have very nominal three goals for today's conversation. First goal is to dispel or correct some of the incorrect understanding about Ayurveda. So when I was growing up, for me, Ayurveda means bitter medicines created out of different parts of plants, especially neem. That was my understanding of Ayurveda for many, many years. And as I started growing up, and as I started reading the popular opinion, I started adding few more keywords. The keywords were Ayurveda is not scientific, Ayurveda is esoteric, Ayurveda is not based on experimentation, we don't do double blind studies, you know, the gold standard in Ayurveda. So these were some of the things that got added. So if any one of you also is coming with this kind of understanding, you are not alone. And that is what we will be answering today. That is what I'll try to correct. The second one is inspire at least some of you to explore Ayurveda with open mind. Because a lot of times we hesitate or we dislike exploring any subject about which we have read or heard a lot of negativity. So one of the important goals of today's conversation is to help remove that negativity towards Ayurveda so that good number of you can explore this subject with an open mind. And of course, help most of you experience that wow feeling that I have been feeling over the last 4 months. Yes, that is the number of months that I have been seriously studying the Ayurvedic texts. So it's been about 4 months now. And the kind of wow feeling that I got, if I'm able to share that and make you feel that feeling, I feel I would have achieved the third goal for today's conversation. Good. So let's roll. Let's start. So I'll start with some keywords which we keep hearing often, but which are translated with very, very limited meaning. So in today's COVID world, one of the most important things is swasthya. And we feel swasthya means just health. It's a lot more deeper. Swasthya means state of being swastha. Now, at every step, you will see how profound this Ayurveda is with the appropriate usage of the Sanskrit words. Ayurveda and Sanskrit are like made for each other. So swasthya is a Sanskrit word. It means state of being swastha. So when you split the word swastha, it is swastha. Stha means to stay. That's where the different words of sthana, sthira, all these things come from. The root word is stha. Stha means to stay. Swastha, that means one who is at home with the self. That means when you are with your original self, that is the true swastha. That is the true swasthya. So at every step, you will see how Ayurveda points to, in addition to physical health, the mental and spiritual health also. Now let's explore a few more words. Aswastha means one who is not at home, who is not in their original state. That is the beginning of the disease. So the actual manifestation of the disease starts a lot before before you actually see the physical symptoms. Chikitsa. Chikitsa means that which helps one to make swastha. Chikitsaka means one who helps you to establish yourself in your original state. That is chikitsa. And the meaning of shariram, there are three different words we use. For all of them, we translate as body, which is incorrect. Shariram, deha, and kaya. Shariram means shiryate iti shariram. Shiryate means that which decays. That is shariram. Because this body decays, we call it a shariram. Deha means dhiganj. It comes from that root word. That means that which grows. So that is because the body also grows since childhood. So that is why we call it deha. And kaya means it encompasses all the metabolism. Okay, we consume food, use that food to grow, and in the process, as we age, it also decays. So both these anabolic and catabolic processes together, we call that as kaya. So at every step, I would encourage you, as you keep listening, to try to think about the how profound our Ayurvedic acharyas have thought about every single aspect of our health and our swasthya. That is few thousand years ago, not yesterday or day before. Roga comes from the root called ruj. Ruj means to split, to hurt, to cause pain. Okay, split means to move away from your original state. That is when we say you are ill, you are sick. Arogyam means being in the state of aroga. That is what is called as arogyam. Swasthya means being in the state of swastha. Okay, so I hope you got a taste of what's going to unfold in the next 60 to 75 minutes. So Ayurveda, the most important texts that are used as a part of Ayurveda are divided into two. One is Brihat Trayi. Trayi means three. Brihat means big. Laghu Trayi means smaller three books. Okay. Actually, it's translated wrongly. It's not small, but in terms of the importance that is given. So Shushruta Samhita, which was documented in 400 BC, that was 2400 years ago. And Charaka Samhita, 200 BC, Ashtanga Hridayam in 400 AD. And Ayurveda itself is lot more older, because most of our thousands of years old knowledge was transmitted orally. Only during that time people started writing it. So it was existing a few hundred years before that, or maybe a few thousand years before that. And in terms of Laghu Trayi, we have three important books: Madhava Nidana 900 AD, which was written in 900 AD, Sarangadhara Samhita in 1300 AD, and Bhava Prakasa in 1600 AD. So if you are an Ayurvedic student, most of the time these are the six books that you will be referring to in order to understand these principles of Ayurveda. Okay, so each of these books, what are they divided into? So we call them as each of the sthana can be translated into a section. And you see that sutra sthana means basic principles, nidana sthana pathology, vimana sthana means specific determination or measurement, sarira sthana is about anatomy, indriya sthana is about sensory organ based prognosis, chikitsa sthana is about therapeutics, kalpa sthana is about pharmaceutics and toxicology, siddhi sthana is about success in treatment, and a few other topics are covered in Kilasthana or Uttarasthana. Uttara means to follow. So 2400 years ago, you see the classification of the text. Okay? And see the number of chapters in each of those sthanas, each of those sections. So you have about, most of them have about 120 chapters, or some like Kashyapa Samhita have 200, and others have 150 or 186 chapters. So some of those is what we are going to get a glimpse of. And all these are written in Sanskrit. So what is the importance of arogyam? According to Ayurveda, why should you be healthy? What is that meaning of arogyam? Dharmartha kama mokshanam arogyam mulam uttamam. So these are the four purusharthas: dharma, artha, kama, moksha. So if you want to achieve these four purusharthas, then the most important foundation for you is your stress-free condition is the best source of virtue, wealth, gratification, and emancipation, the four purusharthas. And I will be using this. This is called as Charita Sutra Sthana, first chapter, and the sutra is 15th sutra. So that is what it means, Charaka Samhita Sutra Sthana. That is what is written in the Charaka Samhita. And another definition from Vaidya P. Ram Manohar, you know, he is the research director at Ayurveda, Amrita Ayurveda College, Vidyalaya, based out of Kerala. So one of my gurus and teachers in Ayurveda. So according to him, how this is translated, Dharmartha Kama Mokshanam Arogyam Mulam Uttamam means pursuit of sensory pleasures and worldly resources in a sustainable manner that eventually leads to freedom from mental bondage. That is the key. As I said, Ayurveda helps you to aim for that ultimate state of liberation, freedom from all sorts of bondage, both at the physical level, mental level, and spiritual level. So that is the underlying philosophy or the goal I would want you to keep thinking about as we keep reviewing some of these contents. So Ayurveda means, comes from two words, Ayu plus Veda. So what does Veda stand, where does Veda come from? Veda comes from the root word called Vid. Vid means to know, to understand, to, okay? And there are four meanings of Veda. Deals with that which exists. That is what we call as Satta, the reality. Deals with conceptualization. That's what we call as Jnana. Deals with analysis, Vichara. And deals with experience, Prapti. So these are all the four things that our original Vedas deal with. They are not some esoteric texts, as we have been, most of us have been made out to believe. This is the profound meaning of what Veda stands for. And what is Ayu, or Ayush as it's called? Sharirendriya Sattva Samyogo Dhari Jivitam. Okay, there is Sharira, Indriya, Sattva, Atma. All four Samyoga means that which come together. That is Ayu. Dhari Jivitam Nityaga Anubandha. These are a Pariyaya Padas or the synonyms. Okay, Ayush is combination of body, sense organs, Sattva means mind and soul. And it has four synonyms. Dhari. Again, see the beauty. Dhari means that which keeps this body together, that which keeps all these things together. Jivitam means that which helps you to live. Nityaga means that which continues. We call it as consciousness. Anubandha means that which maintains that continuity from one birth to the next. All these are called as synonyms. So, and Ayu also has this beautiful meaning. Eti gachati iti ayu. That means that which moves or goes away is ayu. That means every with each passing day, our ayu is reducing. So there are, so Ayush is all about self-preservation at cellular, organismic, and spiritual levels. Shiryate iti shariram. So shariram, the property of the sharira is to decay. So the idea of Ayurveda is to help preserve the body facing the onslaught of these natural elements and trying to preserve the life. And that intelligence that is given to us to preserve our health, what we can call as health intelligence, that is Ayurveda. So Ayush means self-preservation at that cellular, organismic, and spiritual level. So Ayurveda means it is that intelligence, that science, which helps us lead a good, fulfilling, long life. And what is the objective of Ayurveda? Swastasya swastya rakshanam, aturasya vikara prashamanam. Swastasya, one who is healthy, for our conversation, you already heard the meaning of swastya. One who is healthy, help preserve the health. Atura means disease, illness. Aturasya vikara prashamanam. Prashamanam means to reduce. So the objective of Ayurveda is to preserve the health of healthy and cure the disease of unhealthy. Now this is where, in a big way, Ayurveda differs from the current Western medicine. Only when you fall sick, you go to a doctor. That is why in most of today's MBBS, you are taught only about disease and how to treat a disease. Very little is taught about health. But Ayurveda teaches both. It gives equal importance to the both. Actually, the first one is more important. How can you preserve the health of the healthy? That is why Ayurveda is not limited to only treating the sick. And the focus of Ayurveda is how can you live life to its fullest? How can you stay away from diseases? And for whatever reason, if you fall sick, how to come out of it? So that chikitsa, coming out of disease, is only a small portion of Ayurveda. A large part of it is to help you not to fall sick. Beautiful. Preventive medicine is catching up only now in the Western medicine. But that preventive medicine formed the core of Ayurveda. So what is Ayurveda? If we define hitahitam sukham dukkham ayustasya hitahitam manam chatachya yatroktam ayurveda sauchyate. What it means is hitahitam. Ayurveda is that which deals with good, bad, hitam, ahitam, sukham, dukkham, blissful and sorrowful aspects of life. So you see how holistic this is. It does not deal only with sickness. It does not deal only with treatment. It deals with all the four aspects of life. Hita, hitam, sukham, dukkham. Good, bad, blissful and sorrowful aspects of life. And hita, hitam, manam chatachya. So it also deals with what is hitam, ahitam. Here the meaning is, even the same word is used, whatever is wholesome and whatever is unwholesome, to help us lead a long life. That longevity is also another synonym of Ayush. So now you see how beautifully the what is Ayurveda has been defined by Charaka. And this is, and Sushruta. So if you are interested, I will share some of the references. Most of these meanings have taken from a couple of books and a couple of sources. One of them is the Charaka Samhita online. So according to Sushruta, you know, you saw that in the beginning, the Sushruta Samhita, Ayurasmin vidyate anena vayur vidanti vindanti iti Ayurveda. That means Ayurveda is that which deals with Ayu, which has the subject matter as Ayush, and by which one attains Ayush. So you have both the meanings. All aspects of your life, that is Ayush, are also dealt in Ayurveda, and it also helps you attain longevity. Dirghayushman bhava. That is where that Ayush comes from. That is where this meaning of Ayush, that means longevity, also comes from. So what is the scope of Ayurveda? Ayurveda deals with the knowledge of joy and suffering. In a minute, you will see that. What is it that gives us happiness? What is it that gives us sorrow? What is it that gives us benefit? What is it that harms us? What are the authentic things? What are the inauthentic or unauthentic sources of information? And Ayurveda also imparts knowledge about substances, including drugs, along with their properties and actions, and which will, what kind of dravya or element is going to bring us that happiness or health, and what is it that is going to bring us ill health. All of those, including those various substances and properties and their actions, are the ones that are dealt in this Ayurvedic Samhitas. And here I would like to add, remove one misconception. Ayurveda is not just about the bitter liquids or medicines that are made out of different parts of the plant, as I was mentioning. According to Ayurveda, anything and everything in this universe can serve as a medicine if used appropriately. Even poison works as medicine if used appropriately. Even food can become poison if used inappropriately. So what is appropriate, what is inappropriate, that knowledge is what Ayurveda gives. So it does not say eat this food. It does not say all foods are good, or it does not say all foods are bad. That is why in Ayurveda, we say everything is good, we say everything is bad, because it is context specific. It depends on how you are going to use it. And definition of health as per Ayurveda, what does arogyam mean? Samadoshaha, sama agnischa, samadhatu malakriyaha, prasannatmendriyama manah swastha ityabdiyate from Sushruta Samhita Sutrasthana. Now, what does it mean? One is in perfect health when three doshas, in a minute we will explore in detail what these three doshas are, vata, pitta and kapha, digestive fire, very important. Our ability to digest, assimilate and metabolize the things that we consume. All the body tissues and components, dhatus, in a minute you will see what those dhatus are. That is basically the entire physical body. All the excretory functions, the physiological functions of urination and defecation, that is eliminating the toxins from the body. When all of them are in equilibrium, all of them are in perfect order, with a pleasantly disposed, contented mind, senses and spirit. Very, very important. That is why Indriya and Atma are also included along with the body. This is another beauty of Ayurveda. If you go to WHO, so this Sama Doshaha, this Sama, you will keep hearing this word Sama in our scriptures also. Even in Bhagavad Gita, if you look at the shloka, Sama Shatraucha Mitrecha Tata Manava Mana Yoho. So that also talks about samaha shatraucha mitrecha, one who maintains that equanimity, one who maintains that equilibrium. This element of samaha is the key thing that has been explored both in the medical science as a part of Ayurveda and even in all other sciences as a part of yoga also. And it's very interesting. I was just going through, you know, what does WHO, how does WHO define health? It does not still include spirit. It only includes mind and body. And I will share this slide deck. Interested people, please go through this URL. Very interesting definitions of health, which are given only in the last few years, and how they are also talking about maintaining the balance of the body, both internally and externally, is the current agreed upon definition of health. And that is what was given 2500 years ago. Samadoshaha samagnischa samadhatu malakriyaha. So that equilibrium, both internal and external equilibrium, is what Ayurveda defines health as. Now, definition of disease and health. Vikaro dhatu vaishamyam. When those dhatus go out of their equilibrium, that is when you start getting vikara or illness. Okay? So, disequilibrium of dhatus is disease and their equilibrium is health. In a minute, we will explore what that disequilibrium, equilibrium and dhatus are. So, please stay with me. And health is termed as happiness, while disorder or disease as unhappiness. Sukasanyakam arogyam vikaro dukkameva. So it is very clearly recognized thousands of years ago, health is the root cause or the first foundation for happiness. So one more definition, sukha comes with two words. Kha means space. In Sanskrit, the root word kha means space. Sukha. So means that which is good. So sukha means good space. Dukkha. Dhu means that which is restrictive, that which gives pain. Dukkha means being in a space of restriction, being in a space of sorrow. Sukha means good space. It's not just happiness. So when life flows without obstruction, it is called sukha. Dukkha means bad space, obstruction. Kha. As I said, space. Dhu means obstruction or stagnation, something that is not right. Health is a state in which one can be happy and ease with oneself without any external support, without any reason. Beautiful definition. You don't need any reason to be happy. One is healthy when one is happy without a reason. That is another beautiful interpretation of this sutra. Okay, so now I hope you started appreciating how profound the science of Ayurveda is and how beautiful its usage of Sanskrit is. So the three causes of disease, this is one more thing which blew my head away. The first one, before I explain the three, let me spend a little bit of time in talking about one of the important causes of disease as per Ayurveda is prajna parada. Prajna means intellect. Okay, aparadha means incorrect use, when you are making a mistake. most important cause of disease is incorrect use of intellect. And now what are doctors saying? When we eat what we are not supposed to eat, when we don't eat what we are supposed to eat, when we do what we are not supposed to be doing, when we don't do what we are supposed to be doing, the result is disease. And what is this? When we are doing not supposed to be doing, eating not supposed to be eating, that is the incorrect use of intellect. That is the prajnaparadha. So if that prajnaparadha can be fixed, a lot of our ill health reasons can be eliminated. So a lot of health, we can continue to experience that state of swasthya or arogyam, the state of aroga, by correcting our intellect, by correcting the knowledge. So what is that prajnaparadha? What is it that results in disease? Kala buddhi indriyarthanam yogo mithya na cha na cha ti cha. Cha means and. Improper, inadequate and excessive use of time, intellect and sense objects is the threefold cause of both mental and physical disorders. See the beautiful and most profound definition. It's not talking about this pollution. It's not talking about don't eat this, don't eat that. Stepping back and reflecting holistically, this is the profound definition. When you use time, your intellect, and you indulge with your sense objects either inappropriately, improperly, inadequately, or excessively. All of them, inappropriate, inadequate, and excessive. Another definition, inappropriate, excess, or inadequate response to events that unfold in time and space. That is, sense objects are embedded in time and space and unfold in time. That response, when it is not appropriate, that inappropriate response leads to disease. So now you see, health is not just about popping a few pills. Health is a lot more deeper. Health is about we correcting even our thinking, because that incorrect thinking is the root cause of disease. Honestly, this literally blew me away when I read this particular definition of disease. And I think there are some doctors, which I've asked some of my friends, I don't think they would have ever studied this definition of disease as a part of their MBBS curriculum. And according to Ayurveda, we have three pillars of life: Ahara, Nidra, and Brahmacharya. That is Ahara, which talks about food, which is about the fueling this body or this instrument. Nidra is about sleep, resting. And Brahmacharya means it's translated as activity. Brahmacharya is usually translated as celibacy. There is a deeper meaning. What it actually means is Brahma means that which is very big, that which is highest. So Brahmacharya, charya means action, karma. Whatever helps expand your consciousness is Brahmacharya. Okay? Whatever actions you perform to achieve your highest goal is Brahmacharya. So that is how Ahara, Nidra, and Brahmacharya are the three most important pillars of Ayurveda. So one can live a healthy and purposeful life if one knows how to eat, how to rest, how to act. And I would encourage you to use these three and reflect for yourself. It beautifully summarizes these three most important things in life: how to eat, how to rest, and how to act. And in that action is what that prajna or that intellect is already incorporated. So these are the three pillars of life. And Ayurveda is based on very sound philosophy. And that philosophy is what we call as Sankhya philosophy. Sankhya means number, simple translation. Okay, Sankhya means, it has various definitions, but for our conversation, we can say Sankhya comes from this word Sankhya, means number. Why? Because it enumerates the different, whatever we see in universe can be enumerated into 24. Okay, 24 elements. So according to Sankhya philosophy, how did this universe arise? How did this universe come about? This is the theory. There is pure consciousness. Then there is unmanifest primordial matter. We call it as Prakriti. And when Prakriti and Purusha meet, the first thing that we get is that intelligence or Mahat or Buddhi or that ability to discriminate. And when this self-identity, that I, that ego gets added, that is what becomes ahankara. And then we have, from there, you have the sattvic part of the ahankara, which gives rise to mind, the five cognitive senses, and also five active elements, instruments, the karmendriyas, so jnanendriyas and karmendriyas. And from the tamasic elements, we get these five subtle elements, tanmatras, and from those, the five gross elements, the earth, water, fire, air, and space. So sattva, rajas, tamas, three of those, and then the five gross elements, earth, water, fire, air, and space. All these together is what we call as that prakriti. And according to Sankhya, Purusha is the pure consciousness who is just the observer. Now, why is this Sankhya philosophy important? Because you will see as we move forward, everything that Ayurveda deals about, it uses this foundation of these five gross elements and those three subtle elements of sattva, rajas, and tamas. So whatever we are seeing as an object, it has these properties of these five elements, these gross elements, what we call as, and including the treatment comes from this basic foundation. That is why I thought it's useful for us to get a feel for the underlying philosophy. Then it becomes easy for you whenever you listen to Ayurveda or the rest of the conversation, you will know why Ayurveda says what it says, because it is based on this Sankhya philosophy. So what are three doshas? Okay, Vata, Pitta, and Kapha. These are three doshas. I will not translate it. Typically, they are translated as humors, energies. You will understand why I said I'm not going to translate, and I will continue to use these three words, which are what we call as untranslatable words. Why? You will see that. Vata means that which is related to the movement inside the body. So, okay, whatever moves, because that movement is fundamental for life, because if you don't move, that means you're dead. So Akasha and Vayu elements together comprise Vata. Pitta means it comprises the element of Agni that is related to the metabolism. All the transformative elements are considered under Pitta. Kapha means that which is related to structure and storage. And Kapha is a combination of Ap means water, Prithvi means earth. So now you see, when we discussed about the Sankhya philosophy, I told you everything that we see in the observable universe is made up of those five gross elements and those qualities of sattva, rajas, and tamas. So you see that here. So the movement is defined in the form of Akasha and Vayu elements. Pitta in the form of fire. Fire means that which transforms, metabolism. Kapha means structure and storage, that is water and earth, Prithvi. And for those of you who come from the engineering background, here is the systems model of Tridosha. That is, if you see here, any system with feedback can be modeled based on things. Some of the things are transported. You need to have transport. You need to have an input. You need to have an output. Any system, the system is doing something. And whatever input is given, it needs to be transported and converted in order to generate the output. Okay, so every system, input, you have an input, you have an output. But that input needs to be transported and converted in order to generate your output. And in the process, you also need storage or structure. And this is a control system which has feedback built into it. So you have the output with the sensor, which is fed back to the input. And there is a controller. So if you want to control the output, what kind of output you need to get, you need to get a sense of that output so that you can modify your input. So this is the beautiful systems model of any control system. Any system in the world can be modeled in this form. Now you translate that and see how Ayurveda uses exactly the same elements of the systems model and what does it talk about. So this transport element became Vata. The input is our karma and output is karma phala. Okay, and if we consider this as our whole body, this transport became Vata. All those transport elements, that is where the movement comes from. All the conversion, the metabolism is labeled as Pitta. Structure and storage is Kapha. And how do we, you know, how do we experience this karma phala through our indriya, sense organs? And what are the disturbances from the outside? Those are our vikaras. So these indriyas, these sense organs are constantly helping, giving us the sensory input, and controller is our manas. And the goal that we want to achieve in our life, whether it is freedom, liberation or success, that is the sankalpa. So now you see how beautifully these tridoshas model this feedback control system of our human body. There is transport, there is vata, there is conversion, there is pitta, there is structure or storage, there is kapha. There is a sensor, we have the indriyas. The output is the karma phala, the disturbances are the vikaras, and the controller is the manas, the goal is the sankalpa. So now you can see how profound the modeling of the human body is as done by Ayurvedic acharyas using these three doshas. Now, if they are so fundamental, you might ask, these are the fundamental properties of any living system. Something needs to be transported, something needs to be converted, and something needs to be stored. Three most important elements of any living system. But why are they called as dosha? Good question. So the importance of three doshas are, the entire body is the abode of all these three doshas. Okay? When they are normal, recall the definition of health, samadosha. When they are normal, then the result is growth, strength, and happiness. When they are abnormal, when they go out of their equilibrium, the bad outcomes are manifested. And Vata, Pitta, Kapha embrace both the biological and pathological principle. This is the most important and profound insight I want you to understand. The same elements are used not only to model the biology of the human body, but the same elements also give rise to or are used to model the pathology. Because the same elements, when they are in equilibrium, the result is health. The same elements, when they are in disequilibrium, the result is disease. That is why we don't, in Ayurveda, use different nomenclature. The same nomenclature is used. Ayurvedic physiology elucidates and investigates the causes through which the same principles which sustain life and organism, if they are in disequilibrium, they can also bring death. This is the fundamental reason why they are called as doshas. And there's another reason. Dushyante iti doshaha. All these three doshas are always susceptible to get into a state of equilibrium. Based state of disequilibrium. That is, whether it is the impact of the nature, whether it is impact of the things around, whether it is because of prajnaparada, there is a very fine balance that the body maintains of these three doshas. These are called doshas because they are very, very susceptible to get into a state of disequilibrium. So doshas are so called because though they are the lifeline, remember the transport, conversion, and storage, they are also the fault line of the body, biology and pathology. Eventually, they go out of balance and leads to destruction of the body. So doshas are programmed to self-destroy the very body it sustains. Shiryate iti shariram. This happens naturally in the course of time. That is what we call as aging. However, if we follow a bad lifestyle, then doshas can go out of balance and initiate self-destruction at any stage of life. So doshas are called as faults to convey this most important message that we need to constantly make efforts to keep that equilibrium. So what you think, what you breathe, what you eat, how you sleep, how much you sleep, all these impact your doshas. In order to remind us of our responsibility to be ever vigilant, that is where that health intelligence I was talking about, these are called as doshas. See the beauty. So including the words and the corresponding vocabulary chosen is chosen in order to inspire us to lead a good life, to make us more vigilant. So this is another beautiful definition, comes from Sarangadhara Samhita, that is a part of the Lagutrayi. Vata, Pitta, Kapha, when they cause harm to the body, they are called as doshas. When they are in equilibrium, working as complementary to each other and control all the physiological processes of the body, maintaining health, they are called as tridhatus. When they impact rasa and other dhatus, in a minute we'll see what dhatus are, in negative way, they are called as malas. One of the most important definitions that I found, which removed my doubt about these tridoshas, because most Ayurvedic texts or the modern translated Ayurvedic books do not cover this particular important element. The same doshas, when they are under equilibrium, they are also called as dhatus, and the same doshas, when they impact rasa and they go out of equilibrium and impact the body in a negative way, they are called as malas. So now you see, they not only refer to the elements, the five elements, they also refer to the physiological processes, they also refer to the pathological processes. That is why I refused to translate and call them as humors, principles, powers, because they do not capture how profound are the actual activities these three doshas are responsible for. So what are seven dhatus? According to Ayurveda, this body is made up of these seven dhatus. When these all seven are in equilibrium, then we get health. So the first dhatu is rasa dhatu. That means, where does it get nourishment from? From our food. So whatever is the essence of the food that is left after digestion, that essence is what we call as rasa. Okay, and its function is to nourish this body. And what is the dosha that it influences? It is influenced by kapha, rakta dhatu, blood. So this essence from the food is what feeds into blood. So this is what Ayurveda believes in. Okay, this is the system. And from rasa dhatu, you get the rakta dhatu, that is you get the mamsa dhatu. Okay, this is like a step by step. From food, you get rasa, that is the essence. And utilizing rasa, you get rakta. And rakta is what nourishes mamsa, the muscle. And the muscle, from that rakta dhatu, the next dhatu gets nourished, that is medha dhatu. So each one becomes the input for the other. Then from medha, you go to asthi. That is what we call as the bone tissue. And from bone, you go to majja, that is the bone marrow. And from there to shukra dhatu, that is the reproductive system. So you saw the influencing dosha in all this sapta dhatu. Samadhatuscha, that definition that you heard in the beginning about health, is the seven dhatus. So when all these seven dhatus are in equilibrium, they are performing their functions properly, then the result is health. Result is happiness. And all the diseases that we undergo according to Ayurveda are basically related to one of these seven dhatus. And those seven dhatus are in turn related to the same tridoshas. So now you go back to that Sankhya philosophy, how all these three together are coming from that Sankhya philosophy. And one important aspect that you must have heard, you know, whenever you hear about Ayurveda, is that was the general introduction about Ayurveda that I gave you, the most important elements that you keep hearing about are the vocabulary. So Prakriti is what is another very important word used in Ayurveda. Pra means first, Kriti means creation. Prakriti means first creation. The closest that we can translate for the want of words is the constitution of our body. So according to Ayurveda, each one of us is born with a certain predisposition based on which of the doshas, the three doshas, vata, pitta, and kapha, are predominant. So the predominance of doshas gives rise to predisposition to a certain lifestyle. So that is what is called as prakriti. So prakriti is like that factory setting that we get from the mobile. So when we are born with certain prakriti. And in a minute, I'm going to share with you, discuss in little more detail about what prakriti is. So this prakriti is determined by relative predominance of three doshas, vata, pitta, and kapha. And depending upon the relative predominance, we are also predisposed. Now, this is another beautiful insight which blew me away. In a minute, I'll start sharing that and why did I say that it wowed me. So depending on this predominance, there are seven types of prakriti. Okay, Sapta Prakriti Yoga, that is from the Sushruta Samhita Sharira Sthana, 4th chapter, 62nd Sutra. Vata Prakriti, that means predominantly Vata. Pitta Prakriti, that is predominantly the metabolic activities are at the highest. The fire element is highest. Kapha Prakriti, then there is a Dvidosha, that means two, a combination of two prakritis, vata pitta, pitta kapha, kapha vata, and then sama prakriti, sama dosha, vata pitta kapha. So there are seven types. Everybody under the sun, all the human beings can be divided into these seven buckets, because these are the seven kinds of people you see based on the predominance of the particular dosha. And what is it that determines this prakriti? There are many, many elements that determine this prakriti. The first thing is three doshas, vata, pitta, kapha. And these are, how does this relative proportion of this vata, pitta, kapha get determined? First through shukra and shonita, that is basically the sperm and ovum. They are also influenced by the environment, the maternal diet and lifestyle, matur ahara vihara, and age of transmitting patients, that is kala garbhashaya. See the beauty. What kind of body you are getting is a function of sperm, ovum, the kind of environment in which you have taken birth, the kind of food your mother consumed, and the kind of lifestyle your mother was having when she was carrying you, and the age of your parents. Only now science is slowly coming up and acknowledging how the mental state of the mother who's carrying the kid can introduce sometimes really bad predisposition towards mental health onto the kid. But this was given 2500 years ago. So the determinants of prakriti are, they come even before you are born. There are three elements. One is preconception, even before you are born, because according to Ayurveda, as I said, remember, it talks about this eternal soul, that is the Atma. So the before you are born, your prakriti is determined through your karma. That is the purva janma krita karma. That is a metaphysical component. Then the psychological, the sattvaja, and protophysical, that is the mahabhutas, the five mahabhutas which we talked about, the five elements. And so then there is preconception. These are the three elements. There is hereditary. Matraja, pitraja, kulaja, jati. That means the qualities of your mother, your father, the kula that you are born in, you know, here, and the jati. So these are incorrectly translated, or these are the very abused words, but kulaja, jati, and that particular jati that you are formed, or the place that you are formed, also determine your prakriti. And post conception, matrija ahara vihara, the kind of lifestyle and the food your mother has, and pratyatmaniyata. Then postnatal, of course, your personal satmyaja vaya. So how you lead your life, and then the environment, the deha and the kala, what kind of environment you are in. So all these influence our body, and all these are the elements that we need to be aware of, which influence the health. And that is why this prakriti is the fundamental element in Ayurveda in order to determine any sort of medicine or any sort of recommendation in Ayurveda is based on your prakriti. So the more accurate your determination, the Ayurveda Vaidya determines your prakriti, the more accurate will be the diagnosis and treatment. So predisposition, diagnosis and treatment, all three are a function of your prakriti. And the interesting thing about prakriti, based on the hundreds of years of observation, what Ayurveda acharyas have documented is, if you are thin, weakly developed, your skin is dry and rough, and you have not so good digestive capability, there are many of these qualities. I'm not going to go into the detail. You are considered as a vata prakriti. Pitta means one whose digestion is excellent. Okay, metabolism of toxic substances in general is quick. Metabolism, tolerance for matter, you are heat intolerant, disease resistance is good, body frame is medium, body build is moderate. We call that as pitta. Okay, pitta type of person. Kapha means one who has a broad chest, well developed, smooth and firm, thick, smooth and firm, and their metabolism is not so good. So vata is moderate metabolism, pitta is very good metabolism, kapha is poor. Okay, and now you go back to that Sankhya philosophy. Vata is the element of air and akasha. So that is where that dryness, that roughness, and being very quick, talkative, responsive, enthusiastic. So these are all the things that are the characteristics of those two Mahabhutas. Pitta is about fire. So that is where being incisive, sharp, soft, being quick in terms of metabolism, they come from. Kapha, that is where this smooth, firm, because it's all about structure. Up and Prithvi, water and earth, those are the qualities. Little bit slow in grasping and in retention, and their aging is also slow. And you see the predisposition of the kind of diseases that you are predisposed to based on the kind of prakriti you have. And it is this prakriti that has become the foundation for personalized well-being in Ayurveda for these thousands of years. So instead of saying one size fits all, right from the beginning, Ayurvedic acharyas have realized and recognized that each person is unique, and whatever you suggest to that person based on his deha, desha, kala, jati, prakriti, all these elements you need to prescribe. So right from the beginning, Ayurveda was personalized. And what are the factors that are influenced by prakriti? Again, I'm not translating prakriti to constitution or anything. Let's get used to using those original words to understand how profound these words are and how any translation does injustice. So the factors influenced by prakriti are ahara, quantity and quality of food. And based on, again, each food is talked in the form of what kind of dosha it will increase or decrease. So if you are a vata kind of a person, vata prakriti, then you need to avoid all those foods that increase vata. Because if vata increases, it means it is that dosha is getting vitiated, or it is becoming disequilibrium. Then you will get the diseases because of vata dosha. And the interesting concept in Ayurveda, again thousands of years old, is viruddhahara. It is not that each one of us can eat everything and anything. There are certain food things which you need to avoid based on your prakriti. Because as I said, if you are vata kind of a person, vata prakriti person, and you consume food stuff which increase your vata, that is not good for you. So you need to eat food stuff which will pacify vata. That is where this beautiful concept of viruddhahara comes. Vihara, only today, as a part of preventive medicine, All the doctors are shouting from the rooftops talking about lifestyle and lifestyle diseases, because there is only so much those medicines can do. But this vihara or lifestyle has been incorporated as the one of the most important aspects of health right from the beginning in Ayurveda. So this lifestyle includes how you think, what kind of environment you live, how you sleep, what you talk, what you do. All these elements are included as a part of lifestyle. Ahara, vihara, and then, as I said, pathogenesis and manifestation of disease. All these predispositions are governed by that prakriti. So, and accordingly, disease management and usage of medicines are also very closely related to the prakriti. That's why prakriti forms the central element of Ayurveda. And that is where the personalized well-being comes from. So the first thing is about the quantity of food. One must take food in proper quantity, which depends on the strength of Agni. Beautiful. Whatever you can digest, because you may not be able to digest what I digest, and the quantity of food that you consume, I may not be able to consume. That was recognized right in the beginning. So ahara matra, what is my quantity? You need to check yourself, because it is dependent on the digestive power. And what is normal, proper quantity of food? Beautiful definition. That which is digested in due time without disturbing your equilibrium, without disturbing the normalcy. So you see that equanimity, equilibrium once again comes back. So whatever is normal for you may be abnormal for somebody else. So this is another beauty. This is the ambiguity that is built into Ayurveda, where it says there is no such thing as right quantity of food or for everybody. Universally, I cannot say this is right. Universally, I cannot say this is wrong. It all depends on your prakriti. So what quantity of food is right for you depends on your digestive power. So the food taken in right quantity certainly provides strength, complexion, happiness, and longevity without disturbing the normalcy. One should never eat such heavy to digest articles as preparations of flour, rice, flattened rice on top of a meal. You see that? Even while hungry, one should take them in right quantity. You don't unnecessarily stuff yourself, eat anything, everything at any point of time. That is when food becomes poison, because that is when that act of eating itself becomes prajnaparadha. That is incorrect usage of your intellect. And food as per prakriti. So depending on their intensity, you saw that vata kind of people have improper or moderate digestive power. Pitta, excellent. And kapha, slow or less digestive power. Accordingly, there are four types. Tikshana, the digestive power is tikshana means severe, manda means slow, sama means normal, vishama means irregular. So vata is considered as vishama, irregular digestive capability. So the tikshana type is capable of tolerating all types of irregularities, where manda type is opposite nature. So depending on your prakriti, this is how your body responds. You can check. It's beautiful, because I consider myself as a vata person based on the qualities. And yes, right from the childhood, I have been having this irregular digestive capability. I never understood why, but once I started studying Ayurveda, I started understanding. Okay, the balanced type of Agni is basically when things are all in the balance. That means they are neither too low or too much. And in individuals having vata, pitta, and kapha, as you saw, as I said, vata, the digestive power is irregular. So you need to be careful in terms of what you eat, when you eat, how much you eat. Pitta, sharp. So these are the kinds of people, it's like we say, some of the people at home, even if you offer stones to this fellow, he will digest. So that means they have that strong digestive power, the pitta kind of people. Kapha, they have mild, so they won't be able to eat a lot, or they won't be able to eat heavy to digest things. Okay, so based on your prakriti, your sharira develops that kind of digestive strength. So this is a feature. It's not a bug. By understanding the deha prakriti, we need to accordingly change our ahara vihara so that we don't fall sick or we don't go through ill health. And this is where the need for personalized medicine comes from. If you consider English medicine, it is just one size fits all. And that is why every drug, it's very interesting, every drug has side effects. There is no drug that does not have side effects. Because Western medicine tries to split things and also is based on fixing only that problem that you are facing rather than trying to understand how else that particular foreign element like a medicine you are taking inside will impact rest of the body. That specificity is not there in the English medicine because it's targeted only to that and it doesn't worry about what other impact it gives on different parts of the body. But in Ayurveda, it is built in because of this understanding of that Sankhya philosophy and then understanding every single element in this visible universe in the form of those five Mahabhutas. So if you consume this, this is the dosha that it will impact. And if you want to correct it, these are the corrections. And because of this drug side effects, there is a title, there is one type of illness, it's called as iatrogenic illness. That means illness caused by medical treatment. So if you get treated because of too much medicine or too little medicine due to incorrect treatment, especially due to consuming a lot of this medication, if you die, it is called as iatrogenic death. That is death by medicine. And one of the leading causes of death in US, typically US is the one where do a lot of meticulous documentation. That's why, and research. So that's why that country is taken as a standard when discussing. So one of the leading causes of death, in addition to your cardiovascular diseases and cancer, is iatrogenic illness. That is death by medicine. More than 300,000 people die per year in US only because of they have been given too much medication. Because again, because it is not customized. Because most of the English medicine is one size fits all. But we all know one size does not fit all. And if you're interested, you can read that interesting book, Death by Medicine, from where I have taken these insights. And if you search iatrogenic illness on Google, also you will get the meaning. Okay, and that is where the treatment as per Prakriti comes. Okay, examination of the patient is conducted for the knowledge of lifespan or the degree of strength and morbidity. See the beauty. How you need to diagnose is given so beautifully. It says, variations in dosage and potency prescribed for drugs is according to the degree of morbidity and degree of strength of patient. That means what state of life they are in, what dosha they are of, what is their prakriti, depending on that, you customize the same medicine. For some, it is mild, for some, it is moderate, for some, it is tikshna or severe. So not only is your diagnosis, but the medication is also dependent on your prakriti. So the patient should be examined with respect to prakriti, vikriti, the constitution of dhatu, the suitability, their mental state, ahara shakti, your ability to digest the food, and power of exercise, the vyayama shakti, and also age. All these need to be considered while treating a patient. See how profound this is. You don't just give any medicine and every medicine. Okay, you're having cough, you take this medicine. You're feeling fever, take 3 days antibiotics, and along with antibiotics, take this painkiller, and before painkiller, because the antibiotic disturbs your stomach, take a pantoprazole. So you take a pantoprazole before half an hour before you eat, and after you eat, you take this antibiotic and painkiller, and do this for 3 days, at least twice a day or thrice a day. You are a kid, you are an elderly person, you are middle-aged, you are strong, weak, nothing. Just give this. But that is not Ayurveda style. All these need to be considered before you prescribe. Okay. And this is a very simple Ayurvedic cloth that I received from someone, which talks about, again, how the whole body itself goes through different stages and at what part of the day, which particular dosha is predominant, and accordingly, what kind of food or activity needs to be consumed. So you see, whatever we are doing, whatever we are eating, they all come from this framework of these three doshas, Vata, Pitta, Kapha. Everything is aligned. Your prakriti, your bodily, pathological, biological processes, the impact your foodstuff has, the impact your activities have, the impact your thinking has, all of them are based on these three doshas, Vata, Pitta, Kapha, and also Sattva, Rajas, Tamas. And what is the kind of research that is being done on three doshas? These three doshas are a few thousand years old, as you saw. All of this were propounded by Ayurvedic Acharyas using their reflection and observation. They did not do these double blind experiments, or they did not have this huge microscope to peer inside. So is there a physiological equivalent for these three doshas, or are these some esoteric concepts given by some esoteric acharya and everybody is simply started following without any knowledge? Let's explore the research. So there's a test that is, I'm going to share with you a Google Drive, which gives you a lot of this material about the published research. So one of the research paper that got published is there a possibility to find the HLA gene polymorphism based on the concept of Prakriti in Ayurveda? That means, are there any genetic differences between the different kinds of Prakriti? That means Vata kind of a person, Pitta kind of a person, or a Kapha kind of a person. Are these Prakriti differences translating into genetic differences? They did that in this HLA gene, and the result is there was a reasonable correlation between HLA type and Prakriti type observed. So there was complete absence of the DRB1 star 0. Okay, I won't go into the details. Just it shows that the difference in Prakriti, they were able to observe even at the genetic level. You are interested in learning about this? This paper I've already placed in the Google Drive, which I will share at the end of this session. You can read that paper. Are there any physiological equivalents of Tridosha? Because we heard that individuals with Pitta Prakriti are fast metabolizers, individuals with Kapha Prakriti are slow metabolizers. Is that true? Are there physiological equivalents? So drug metabolism rate associated with drug metabolizing enzyme. So that particular gene, which they tried to do the genotyping, CYP2C19, and this is the result. Extensive metabolizer genotype found predominantly in Pitta Prakriti. That's what Ayurveda says. If you are Pitta Prakriti, it means you have excellent metabolism capability. And that's what this research is talking about. Poor metabolizer genotype. You remember Kapha kind of Prakriti has poor metabolism, was highest in Kapha Prakriti compared with Vata and Pitta. So you see that? So there also seems to be the physiological equivalents of this Tridosha. Why I am presenting this research? Just to show you that these Tridoshas are not some random concept that Ayurveda is based on. This is properly used or abused word scientific. So the peripheral blood samples of individuals were analyzed for genome-wide expression levels, biochemical and hematological parameters as per Prakriti. So they wanted to see if there are any biochemical or genome-wide expression of these hematological parameters. And the result, the biochemical profiles like liver function test, lipid profiles, they exhibited differences between Prakriti types. So functional categories of genes showing different expression among Prakriti types were significantly enriched in core biological processes. Remember, the core biological processes are transportation, transformation, and storage. So significant enrichment of housekeeping, disease-related and hub genes were observed in these extreme constitution types. That means not only at the genomic level, they are also observed at these differences in different prakritis are also observed in their biochemical markers. Whenever you go to a test for your sugar levels or your lipid profile, what they are measuring is those biochemical markers. So this research, the published research shows that even at the biochemical level, you can observe differences between different forms of prakriti. So this clearly shows that this classification is very profound and scientific, and it is not random. So I just gave you the repetition of how these different kinds of prakritis have different kinds of phenotype features. Phenotype means the physiological expression of that quality inside, that genetic characteristic is called as phenotype. So the genotype is the gene. The phenotype is the external manifestation. You know, these blue eyes, black eyes, the hair color, all are the build of your body. These are all phenotype expressions. So Ayurveda uses these phenotype differences also in order to categorize your or determine your prakriti. So the current state of prakriti, because prakriti is central for Ayurveda. So how do we assess? So there are many assessments developed by Ayurveda clinicians based on the phenotype characteristics for each prakriti as given in Ayurvedic Samhitas. But there is still no one standard prakriti assessment tool universally accepted. You know, according to some Ayurveda Vaidyas, it's at least another decade away before we come up with a universal prakriti assessment tool. So interesting. There is Dr. Anirudh. He is a PhD in computer science from IIT Bombay. He developed this Nadi Tarangin machine, which helps you determine your prakriti and your predisposition based on your Nadi. Nadi means your pulse. That is another very well developed area in Ayurveda, where your pulse can give you a lot of information about your prakriti, your predisposition, and your ability to contract different diseases. Your susceptibility of different diseases in near future can also be found from this Nadi. So he has created this Nadi Tarangini machine. I gave you the URL, which is being used by more than 500 Ayurvedic doctors all over India, in terms of helping people personalize their well-being insights based on their Nadi. And this is the machine. And he also came up with another wonderful machine called Turiya, I think, which will be released in the next few weeks, which can be used independently, individually by ourselves, which also once again functions based on this Nadi Tarangini principles, but which will help you give personalized recommendations. So some questionnaires and published papers, as I said, tinyurl.com/bala-prakriti. I'm not narcissistic to call it as Bala Prakriti, because the tinyurl.com/prakriti was taken by somebody else. So in order to be more specific, I used my name. So Bala-prakriti, if you go to this URL, it will redirect you to a Google Drive where I have placed a lot of published papers on prakriti assessment, on prakriti, and some of the papers that I have referred to show you how the principles of Ayurveda are very, very profound and very, very scientific. And what is my work? What is the PhD that I'm trying to do? So the motivation is there anything that Ayurveda can provide to alleviate the impact of modern lifestyle habits? That is the prajnaparada that is coming in because of the issues in vihara, the lifestyle. Is there anything in Ayurveda This is the question I asked. This is what was motivating me. For example, we have people working late nights. We have people stuck to their screens or stuck to their chair. Some of those we can't avoid. So these are the modern lifestyles. But is there something in Ayurveda that can help personalize and improve the well-being of the people based on the lifestyle they are following? So that's the goal is to develop a framework for personalized well-being using Ayurvedic principles. So if you are Vata kind of a person and you have to work in shifts, is that in first place suitable? And if it is not suitable, but still that is what you need to work with, how can you minimize the negative impact? Because again, every lifestyle habit has an impact on one of those tridoshas, either Vata, Pitta or Kapha. So what kind of lifestyle habits, including Ahara and Vihara, food and lifestyle, what is it that can minimize that particular impact of the dosha so that they can come back to the normal state, both internally and externally? So what are those inputs? So my interest is to build that kind of a framework for that personalized well-being. So Prakriti, Vikriti, profession, Triguna. Sattva, Rajas, Tamas is what we call as Triguna. Location, season, and lifestyle habits. So to develop a personalized well-being framework, considering all these elements. So these are some of the references. So the ones that I have followed in order to give you an insight, the original text is, I am following this Charaka Samhita English translation by Dr. P.V. Sharma and Dr. P.V. Tiwari. Sushruta Samhita English translation, the 1907 edition is what I'm following. Ashtanga Hridayam by Dr. Iyer Vidyanath. All these books are published by Chaukamba Publications. A very interesting publishing house. They have been publishing books in both. This is a Varanasi-based publishers. They have been publishing books on Sanskrit and Ayurveda for the last 150 years, not just 1 or 2 years. And Sarangadhar Samhita I was referring to, I picked it up from this website, archive.org. And many of the concepts that I referred to come from the Vaidya Ram Manoharji's talks on YouTube. So if you go to YouTube, search Ram Manohar, Ayurveda, you will get a bunch of his talks. Very, very insightful. I would encourage you folks who are interested in Ayurveda to go through his talks to develop these more interesting insights. Wonderful. So that brings us to the end. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha, Sarve Santu Niramaya, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhavet. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Especially during these COVID times, may all be prosperous and happy. May all be free from illness. May all see what is spiritually uplifting. May no one suffer in any way. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Thank you very much. Good.
Thanks, Balaji. Brilliant presentation. I didn't get any questions at all, which is, I think, a testimony to the way you have presented, anticipating and answering all the questions. So I have one for you, very quick one. You talked about kula and jati, and you said it is a much abused words.
Correct.
So do you want to share a bit of insight on what this actually means and what is the difference?
Yeah, see. Kula does not mean caste. Okay? Jati does not mean race.
Right.
It is dependent on the kind of group of people whom you are a part of in that particular geographic location doing those particular kinds of activities. That is why we have Varnasrama and jati and varna. We don't talk about caste as something you are born into or that which cannot be changed.
Yeah.
Okay, so these are the European definitions that are imposed on the India and trying to look at what is there in India from the European mindset. That's the sad part.
Yeah.
For example,
I would encourage
please look at this website called indictoday.com, which gives some really interesting articles talking about the difference between this varna, jati, and kula.
Okay.
Yeah. Somebody was asking something.
Puruji.
They want to unmute.
Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah. Hi. Hey, thank you. It was a very nice presentation. I just have a very generic question. See, on the, in the modern Western medicine, it seems to be very mechanistic to me. You know, they break it down into, very, very minute structures.
Yes.
Like, RNA, DNA, T cells.
Yes.
Etc. Right.
Yes.
But if I see the contrast in Ayurveda, they don't go into such very abstruse, abstract levels, very microscopic levels. They're very comfortable in just like you said, the three combinations, those permutations, combinations, and that is more than enough. Right. Now with that, I also see because there is so much of predominance of really the Western methods that we're still trying to correlate it. And I'm not necessarily against it, by doing the same kind of correlation analysis and so on.
Yeah.
But in some ways, I also see it as, the Indian lifestyle is also in ways similar. You don't go into extremely detailed ways. But what my question therefore is, and, I've been actually asking this to Ayurvedic doctors also very recently. Why is it that... what is the need to go to such detailed levels at all in terms of medicine? And, is that really the right way? I'm a little troubled.
Don't get troubled, Puruji. Let me answer the question.
Yeah.
The way you design your life, the way you design your sciences is based on a world view. Mm-hmm. Very, very important.
Mm-hmm.
West has this world view of breaking apart and trying to find out what is that key element.
Mm.
If there is a flower or a tree or a fruit that Ayurveda says, this is what helps you, then the Western mindset, the worldview is not sufficient in eating a mango. It says, what is there in that mango that is giving the sweetness? Let me break it apart.
Mm.
And in the process of breaking, because they are looking for that one thing, they are completely losing sight of the relationships which act in conjunction to give you the taste of the mango.
Mm-hmm.
So many elements are thrown out of the window. We are looking only for that element. That is why when you consume it in its original state, which is natural, the impact is different. When you completely distill it out and say, this is the element, and then take it, you see so many side effects.
Mm-hmm.
The fundamental aspect comes from that worldview. We should not be asking why. It's not, I don't know if you're a software programmer, it's not a bug, it's a feature. Because their worldview is to break things apart. That is the Newtonian worldview. So they will always look to break things. If you can just give me 1 second, I will share something very, very interesting. The latest fad in food is to find out what is the key element that makes the food it is.
Mm-hmm.
And they want to find out what is that critical element. And unfortunately, there is no such critical element there, because it is all a conjunction or that which is related together, which are working in order to give that impact. Let me give you an example.
Mm-hmm.
I used to ask the same question until recently, just a couple of months ago. I used to ask, see, our Western trained mindset, what kind of questions come? Because our whole thinking is, I'm sorry, completely screwed up.
Right.
I was asking, food is carbohydrates, fats, proteins, minerals, vitamins.
Yep. Correct?
This is what we are fed, our brain. And then I started asking this to all the Ayurveda Acharyas, and the books and the papers I've started reading. I said, equivalent to fat and proteins and carbohydrates, what do you have in Ayurveda? What do you have in Ayurveda? Mm-hmm. And I realized only a lot later that that is a completely wrong question to ask.
Mm.
Because Ayurveda functions, it is a functional science where it talks about the impact that it is having on the body and then accordingly changes itself based on thousands of years of observation. So there is no, this mindset of splitting the food, that is why you have a paleolithic diet, you have a keto diet, you have this diet, that diet, because each one of them is focusing on one element, letting go of this beautiful interrelation and interaction. That is what Ayurveda does, because it takes the functional perspective. It does not eliminate anything. Have a look at this website that I have just given here, and you will, it will be mind-boggling what the researchers are trying to do in order to find out the key nutrients of every single food we consume, and it is endless. They take your turmeric. Yeah. They take your, ginger. Now they want to know what is the key element of that ginger, and then keep splitting, and then they still feel so, the key nutrient is not present.
Mm-hmm. In general,
so there is no end.
It's my observation that Indian sciences and knowledge systems seem to come from a connected worldview,
exactly.
Where everything is integrated.
Holistic.
So what we mean by what we call holistic, and there's another word, holographic. And whereas the Western worldview is essentially disconnected and fragmented. So it believes that something is created by joining parts together. Whereas we say that there is one
whole,
and then it has many parts which has their own role, but they're all part of one unity.
Yeah.
So this fundamental worldview probably explains the difference in approach. And
Until we understand and appreciate this worldview, we will continue to ask wrong questions and we will continue to ask wrong set of people.
Yeah. We are actually exceeding the time. So just one last question from Donald Patel. Is there any sign from the wishes that we have from which we can identify our prakriti?
Wishes.
Wishes means our karma, what we want, what we desire. Does that give a clue to our prakriti? Is, I think, what he's asking. If I understood.
That is just one set. That's why I'm saying, that's why I gave you that whole big picture of prakriti. It is not so easy. It that can be one of the elements, but you should not base your prakriti only on that one element. So please remember that.
Okay. Right. Thanks very much. With that, we will conclude the session. Thank you, everybody, for joining. Thank you, Balakishoreji, for a wonderful presentation. I've already shared the link for registering in case somebody has not registered for future updates, as well as for receiving the presentation and the recording link. Please register at the site that I had mentioned earlier. With that, we will conclude. Namaste Sarvebhya. Bahu Dhanyavada.
Thank you. Namaste.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.